X number of years later, the big country comes and, you know, my dad goes to cast Major Terrell with Bickford, and he's, you know, I think he held a bit of a grudge. So he probably had to be convinced to take him, but I also think he cast him a little bit to get a little revenge, right?
Well, Charles Bickford as the unrelenting range baron.
What do you want, Hennessy?
You set foot in Blanco Canyon once more, and this country's gonna run red with blood. Here, start now.
Hi, I'm Rob Word. Welcome to A Word on Westerns. Today we are honoring one of the greatest directors in film history, William Wyler. He directed one of my favorite Westerns, The Big Country, also The Westerner with Gary Cooper and Walter Brennan, Friendly Persuasion, and he began his career with silent one and two reel Westerns. So, to help us discover these films and to talk about them are his children, Catherine and David Wyler. David.
Hi, Rob. Howdy.
Catherine, how are you?
Have a seat.
Well, I've been doing a lot of screening of your dad's films for the past 50 years, okay?
That's all we.
Yeah.
All our lives we've been screening them.
Boy, I tell you, they really hold up, and the performances that he gets, I think next to John Ford, I think had 20 nominations for his films, and he won 3 Academy Awards for directing. Just a phenomenal success. But I want to hear about his early films, which you may have screened. I know they're difficult to find. The silent two-reel Westerns that he made.
We actually, going after he passed away, we found he'd given some things to UCLA, but we found other things in the basement. And in the basement were all the files from the 1920s that he'd kept, including many of the universal interoffice memos that were sent to the various film crews as they, you know, he started off doing one reel Westerns, which were 15 minutes, and before he graduated to the 2 reel ones. And we actually found several memos, from Universal Management saying, you know, Wyler's terrible. This thing is over budget. It's too long. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't look good. And you know, some of the memos at the very beginning were now were very funny in retrospect because they didn't augur well for him. But clearly, he learned his way through. And I was fortunate enough to see some of his 1 and 2 reel Westerns at the American Cinematheque many years ago. And the early ones were terrible. But by, the later ones, the framing was much better.
They were 1 hour features then. He was doing 53 minute, 60 minute ones with Fred Hume, I think.
Yes, he graduated to that. Before mm-hmm. that, he was actually doing 20 minute, the first 20, 20 minute short ones, which was essentially, good guy, bad guy, good guy gets girl, bad guy is captured.
My favorite thing he said about those years was that he used to spend sleepless nights trying to figure out a new way to get a man on or off a horse.
He also liked to say that, back in the day, he would always tell the good guy from the bad guy because the good guy would come out of the saloon to the porch and pet the dog, and the bad guy would come out and kick the dog. He also would say that they didn't necessarily have enough people for a posse. So if they were short a few people on the posse, he and some of the other production people would saddle up and be riding in the back with the posse as they were shot.
Now, your dad, just like so many of the other early filmmakers from Europe who came in, he was related, I think, to Carl Laemmle.
He came over first class with Carl Laemmle on a boat, and unfortunately he found that the cost of the ticket was withdrawn from his salary weekly for the next year.
Well, I don't think that's changed much with the way studios
exactly,
work. But
exactly.
So he started... At what level with Universal?
He started actually in New York, carrying film cans around town.
As a messenger.
And he was in New York for just a year or so, and realized, of course, that all the fun was in California. And so once again, Carl Laemmle paid his train fare.
Advanced him.
Advanced him.
Exactly, and he had to pay him back $5 a week.
Well, boy, I tell you, I would love to see a lot of those early silent westerns. There's something about them, and for you to have gone through the paperwork too, I'm sure if you saw them in chronological order, you'd see his progression as a great filmmaker.
When I saw them at the American Cinematheque, you could see them getting better. It was really interesting.
Well, they must have trusted him at Universal because he directed Universal's first talking picture, which happened to be a Western, Hell's Heroes, which was the first version of Three Godfathers.
Yeah, I'm not sure it was the first. I think it was the second version.
The
of
first
Three
sound
Godfathers.
Version, let's
the
say
first
that.
First sound version.
And Charles Bickford was in that.
Yes.
As well. How does that film hold up, do you think?
I think surprisingly well.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, you can definitely enjoy that film today.
One of the things he talked about was trying to use the visual medium to tell the story. And there's the story of the Three Godfathers as they find a baby and they're in the middle of the desert and they've robbed a bank and they're trying to get across the desert with the money to escape. And of course, they also take the baby. And then there becomes a choice of what do they want to give up on their way because they run out of water. And so one of the things he did was, I remember one shot where you just follow a line in a furrow in the sand for, 5 or 6 seconds, what seems a long time. And then you see a dropped rifle. And so these markings, he really learned and became very good at telling a story visually. And in Hell's Heroes, that was really remarked upon, with that. The other thing was that Charles Bickford at the time, I remember, was a well-known actor.
That's right.
And from what I gather, a bit full of himself. And treated this first-time director, sort of with a little bit of the back of his hand, and maybe a little roughly. So, X number of years later, The Big Country comes, and my dad goes to cast Major Terrell with Bickford, and he's, I think he held a bit of a grudge. So he probably had to be convinced to take him, but I also think he cast him a little bit to get a little revenge, right?
Charles Bickford as the unrelenting range baron.
What do you want, Hennessy?
You set foot in Blanco Canyon once more, and this country's gonna run red with blood till there ain't one of us left. Now, I don't hold mine so precious, so if you want to start, here. Start now.
The Big Country was a massive production with one of the most exciting cast of the time. Chuck Heston wasn't quite the big star that he was going to become the next year when he did Ben-Hur for your dad, but it had Burl Ives, who got an Oscar, known as a folk singer, Little White Duck. He was great in this as this gnarly, bigger-than-life head of the household, which the house was a shack.
One! 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10,
Ready! Aim!
Fabulous cast.
Chuck Connors' first
movie. And Chuck Connors wasn't known at the time.
No, and had that great mustache and gave such a wonderful performance in that. But Charles Bickford, who didn't know how to ride, he said, I don't know that your dad remembered that I don't know how to ride, and maybe that was part of the torture that your dad was going to have.
The story I heard was that my father was assured that Bickford could ride, and that he had no problem getting up on a horse. And it was only in production he found out that Bickford had a problem with his leg and couldn't get on a horse. And it really made him angry. So if you notice, you'll never see Major Turrell get on the horse. They always cut to. I don't know why it made my father so angry, because the actor in The Little Foxes had a bad leg.
Oh, that's right. But he didn't have to get on a horse.
Right, that's true.
American pioneer spirit on the march. First came the cattlemen, and with them, Roy Bean, a self-appointed judge, who took the law into his own hands. Hey!
Let's talk now about The Westerner, William Wyler's classic movie with Gary Cooper and Walter Brennan, who I guess that's one of his third Oscars that he picked up for The Westerner, too, as Judge Roy Bean. Beautifully shot in black and white. Cooper gets a lot of accolades for High Noon and Sergeant York and Oscars. This performance is just as strong, just as good as that.
But if it was my own son come over here with a warrant, he'd have to be first in the draw.
I aim to be. Unless I get it in the back before I get out of here.
The thing that a lot of people, I think, miss about our father, William Wyler, is what a great sense of humor he had. On one hand, he was a very stern director. He knew what he wanted. He went for it, and he was, you know, making sure to get it. On the other hand, he loved a great joke. He loved being mischievous. And you get that whole sense of humor from The Westerner. His sense of humor, the relationship, the way Cooper plays against Judge Roy Bean is friendly and funny, and he's going to be hung at the beginning, and then they make fun of each other. And then they
wake up with a hangover together.
So I think what you really see, and you see it in Roman Holiday too, all these funny physical moments, and that's what William Wyler was really about. He had a great sense of humor. He loved to laugh. He loved to be mischievous, as long as he got his way. And I think you really see that in The Westerner in terms of that relationship.
It's really unique, and I think his casting, again, so much of it is casting. Like you said, he wants to find a professional actor who's going to do his job and leave it up to him to find those moments, and then your dad finds it in editing.
And I what I never realized until recently is, having worked in all the silent films in the 20s, he knew all. He worked. The Tom Tyler is in The Westerner and is shot in the first 15 minutes, right? And he'd worked with Tom Tyler, earlier on some other one or two-reeler Western. I think it was bringing those guys back and using it was great.
Mm-hmm. He used Cooper again in. It's not really a Western, Friendly Persuasion, but it is a beautiful film and about the pacifist family. And there's so much humor in that. In fact, he even got Gary Cooper to sing in that movie.
That's right.
How did that happen?
Oh boy, I have no idea how that happened. In fact, I live in Washington, D.C., and I just sat with Maria Cooper, Gary Cooper's daughter, for a screening of Friendly Persuasion. But nobody asked about how that came about, so I can't tell you.
I heard that Cooper had to be convinced. That there was a lot of convincing for Cooper to get Cooper to do it. But because the Westerner had been so successful, and you know William Wyler had such a great track record, he was going to take a role that was really different from what he'd done before.
Well, and also, and to that point, Maria said that what was hard about it was that he was so used to being the macho star, and now he was going to be a guy with these grown children.
It was a pacifist.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, I sure appreciate both of you being here, and I love your dad's films, and this just makes me want to see them again and again and again. Thanks for being
here. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you all.
I'm Rob Word. Thank you for joining us today. I hope you had a good time. We did. And we'd have a better time if we knew you were a subscriber. If you left us a comment, tell us what you want to see, and we'll hope to bring it to you next time on A Word on Westerns.